Hi everyone, I'm Ramit. I'm currently a lead data scientist at ShareChat. Just recently joined after completing a technical lead stint at Tower Research for the past 3 years. And along with that, I've been fortunate to work with Professor Rajiv, who we have on this call with us today. He's a professor at IIIT Delhi. Before that, he's completed a PhD in the National University of Singapore. And he's also the director and founder of the Midas Lab at IIIT Delhi, which has been basically the source which has led to all of everything that I've learned in research in the last 3 years. So in a way, my guru is here for this call. And today with him, we'll be going briefly over some of the very commonly asked questions that we've been getting from the last 1 month around machine learning, data science careers, artificial intelligence, what is next in research, all of these kind of questions. We have our expert to help answer with these. And before we begin with some of these audience questions, we'd like to start by getting a little bit more about Professor Rajiv. So Professor Rajiv, if you could give a brief introduction on how you started, what has your journey been, and how you've got to the place where you're a director at the Midas Lab publishing so many great papers.
Thank you so much, Ramit. And it is my pleasure and honor to be here. And thank you for inviting me for this talk. And I hope I can answer some of the questions from the different students and somehow help them in their career or probably could be a kind of torchbearer for them. And in our life, I mean, there is always some torchbearer who show us the direction. So in my life as well, there are many. And so whatever I'm today, definitely due to the help and probably the direction that they have shown. So regarding my journey, so I am from Banaras, and I've done my schooling from Banaras itself. And after the schooling, I moved for my undergraduate study to Banaras Hindu University, majoring in mathematics. So I did my basically undergraduate in mathematics honors. So during my undergraduation, basically, there was a course on programming. So that is deals with how you can basically do some small programming. So my interaction with the programming and computer science started there during my BSc. So though Computer Science Association started there, I was not so much into the computer science because I was basically too much into the mathematics. I like the theory of computation, all these courses. I wanted to pursue basically my research, I would say the career. Again, the research is something which started very late after that. So since I was from a kind of humble background, so though I wanted to do higher studies, but I have realized it's better to probably look for the career which can also give you good job profile. And during that time, my elder brother basically was doing his BTech from MNNIT Allahabad. So that is very well known, at least in the area of computer science, electronics, and all those. So during the summer break, I visited the campus and I really liked the environment and probably also heard about, okay, so how the different students getting placed to the top companies. And also, at that time, I was only looking for the job opportunity, probably the career which can help me in at least getting good direction and probably maybe give me a high paying job. So I was only aiming for high paying job or at least some job profile in computer science. And that's how I got to know, okay, so after my BSc honors, I can enter formally in computer science program through a program called MCA, Master in Computer Application. And that's how I given the entrance examination in different universities across the India. And fortunately, I was able to secure places in almost all the places. And finally, I've decided to choose Jawaharlal Nehru University for my master's. So it was amazing journey at JNU. For my master's, I learned and gone through all the fundamental courses of the computer science, starting from probability statistics to linear algebra to any algorithm and programming and data science, data structure, operating system, and all those. So that is formally has given me 3 years education in computer science. And since we are located in Delhi, we also attract a number of good companies. And after my MCA, I got placed to a company called Ericsson Communication, so in Gurgaon. So that's how I moved to software industry after my master's. And since somewhere in my mind, I wanted to pursue higher studies. But during my early days, I have seen at least I have struggled in terms of money, in terms of facilities. So I really wanted to go for job. So I started my job at Edison Technology as a software engineer. And but after working for a year, I would say approximately 1.5 years, I have re realized that so probably software industry is not the best place for me, at least at that moment, because actually that was the time when the recession enters in India. So that is 2005, when I mean a lot of things happening globally in terms of recession. So
Right.
I have seen that. So despite, I mean, I was doing well. I was it was a good job. It was very good learning profile. But one thing I've realized that like the amount of effort and work I am doing, I'm not probably getting the outcome for that. And it's basically more 9 to 5 job, and probably there is not much to learn. Because when we were in, I mean, usually at least in me, when I was in my master's, I've gone through, I mean, very competitive programming, all those programming. And but once you come enter through the company, I mean, during the study you study linked list, you miss a very complex program. But once you reach to the companies, my experience was very, very different. I mean, you have given a programming stack, and now you need to just focus on some part and don't have to probably miss that up. So at least the learning experience which I was getting, I was not very much satisfied. So I consulted my brother. So fortunately, my family and brothers are very, very supportive. And they said, okay, so if you don't like, I mean, it's fine. I mean, whatever our past was, but at least both of us are kind of in good position to support you in case you want to go for higher studies. So they have motivated me to basically, okay, so you can, if you want, go for higher studies. And that's how after 1.5 years, I left my job around October 2009. So at that time, I did not have any clue how to go for higher studies, because I have completed Master of Computer Application, which is treated more as a application. I would say the degree, it's kind of towards more, not towards well known for the research, I would say. And in fact, that is true as well, because we have not taught, and we were not doing any research as part of the course. It's more like towards the computer science applications. So I spoke to a number of people, what can be done? So one of my seniors from JNU basically just got admitted to National University of Singapore for his PhD. And I spoke to him, I spoke to a number of people as well. Okay, so, and I thought, okay, so let me apply to the different places where I can probably do research. I can enjoy at least what I have probably envisioned earlier. So that's how I left my job. I did not had anything in my hand, in no offer or so. So after exploring a number of places, I found, okay, so what are the places where basically you can apply for PhD? So in India, I have looked for ISC. Okay, I looked for TIFR, Tata Institute of Fundamental Research, and I found that, okay, so these are amazing places, even IITs, where basically you can go for higher studies. So okay, so these are the places I thought, okay, I can apply. So I have given again, I basically, since I've taken break in October, I have basically prepared for GATE, because that is the way you can go for at least go for master's program or the PhD program in India. So that is, I in one direction I started looking for that opportunity. In parallel, I have started applying for PhD abroad as well, because I mean, one thing definitely, I mean, I wanted to pursue research, but at the same time, I would like to explore the world as well. Because usually I travel, I like traveling. So when I spoke to a number of people, I found that, okay, so during PhD is also something, it's not only do research, but also get opportunity to visit different places and all those. So keeping this in mind, I applied different places. And unfortunately, I mean, I have got selected to the written exams in some of the places, but could not qualify, I would say, the final entrance. For example, for TIFR, I cleared the written, but I could not finally clear the basically the interview part. So, but that's how, I mean, it was kind of disheartening. But at the same time, since I have decided I have to go, there is no way I want to come back to industry again, at least not very soon. So I decided, okay, so let's go for GATE as well. So through the GATE, I mean, I prepared for 2 3 months by myself, and given the GATE exam in February, I think, yeah, February 2010. And that's how, I mean, fortunately, I was able to secure good ranks and got a couple of offers for my MTech, because some of my seniors basically suggested, since MCA is not treated more as a research-oriented program, so it's better to basically go for MTech, which is well known in not only in India but also abroad, which can help you in giving the good PhD offers. And that really worked for me. I took admission to DTU, Delhi Technological University, which is formerly known as Delhi College of Engineering. And that has basically started giving me more confidence. I started interacting with more people, started doing a little bit research in information retrieval. So that is, at that time, I mean, I recall one of the first challenge I have participated in, SMS-based FAQ retrieval. So where the input is just an SMS, which is not, I would say, a complete sentence, a word, where you use the abbreviation. So that's how I started my journey in basically the information retrieval direction. And that has also finally yielded into one of the paper at the FIRE conference, Forum for Information Retrieval. And I have attended my first conference at IIT Bombay. And that has given me further confidence and also basically the motivation to pursue further. As I mentioned, in your life, there will be always a number of people who motivate you and support you during this journey as well. A number of people and my professor and colleagues, friends supported me throughout this. And after this paper, I have also, since I have already started applying for different PhD positions at different universities, during my master itself, I have started applying to some of the places. And fortunately, I got PhD position from National University of Singapore. And that's basically was a great news for me. And after that, I did not sit in the placement because I never wanted to go into industry, at least not very soon. So I got my PhD offer in between the masters during my MTech at DTU. And I did not sit in the placements and I joined a PhD program at NUS Singapore. And after reaching there, one thing I realized, I mean, definitely, why universities, despite Singapore is very, very small as compared to India, but they have many world-class universities like NUS, NTU, and recently they started SUTD and SMU, which are also doing equally very, very well. So the reason being they are excelling in the research because they do understand we need to provide all the facility, all the infrastructure to the students. And definitely, I mean, they also need to probably have the world-class facility, resources, teachers, and everything. So I really struggled in the first semester because it was a transition for me where I have studied. I'm not criticizing like the courses or rigorousness in Indian institutes, at least where I have studied. But I have seen, like, at least as compared to what I have gone through before, there was tremendous or multiple, I would say, the multiple times tougher curriculum and probably the rigorousness I have seen. So in the first semester, I struggled, but fortunately, I worked hard and I settled there and I started my research there under the supervision of Professor Roger Zimmerman, a great person, a great supervisor who always encourage and motivate to pursue whatever you like. I mean, he has given me the flexibility. Okay, so you are free to do anything and we will figure out later how to basically stitch all the work together, because anyways, whatever the work you're going to do is somehow related. So you don't have to worry too much about a PhD at the moment. Right now, your focus should be learning. He encouraged me to participate in challenges, in the submitting paper to workshop, to the conference, journals, and basically collaborate with as many as people as you can. Meet at the people, build your network. And that's that thing basically helped me a lot in basically growing in my career, at least what I follow. Because definitely alone you can do good work, but if you want to increase the impact of your work, you will have to do with the team. And that is the fundamental thing I always follow, and that is the reason whatever I'm doing today at IIIT Delhi, probably I will cover more details on that. It's all due to the amazing students, colleagues, collaborators, friends I have, because I mean, together we can. Together we can do great work. And that's how, I mean, I started my PhD journey at NUS Singapore. I was fortunate to learn a lot of from him, my colleagues, my friends. Even, I mean, that has helped me to visit approximately 15 to 16 countries during my PhD itself. to explore, to learn from the different people, different culture. And it was amazing journey. And after that, I wanted to come back to India. I wanted to join academia. And so around my PhD thesis submission, I have basically discussed with a couple of seniors and my supervisor, mentors, where should I apply? So many of them suggested, I mean, the IIIT Delhi is the place where you should go, you should look for. And that is the reason I have only applied to IIIT Delhi, nowhere else in India. And I was very fortunate to get the position there even before I have I've done my PhD defense. And so it's a great supportive environment at IIIT Delhi. And that's why basically, despite it is just 11 years old, it is excelling in different research areas. So be it in computer science, be in SCI, and so on. So before joining to IIIT Delhi, I have requested, I wanted to have a postdoc experience before my PhD. And IIIT Delhi has kindly agreed me to allow me to basically do my postdoc. I had a couple of offers, but since I had planned to come back to India soon after this, so I had offered from Singapore, some of the places in Europe. And so thanks to everyone. So finally, I have joined Singapore Management University because that is closer to the area I was working, social media computing. And after working there, learning a lot. And there, basically, I have seen. So during my association with SMU, so I have learned that. So before joining SMU, people say, I mean, you're going to join a management university. Then I got to know management is not only about people. Management is not only about business. Management is also about data. And right. That's how the data I have, I mean, though I was dealing with data earlier, but my association with the SMU has taught me basically, okay, so the data management, data science is something, I mean, which is great area. And that is the time basically a lot of focus has started on machine learning, deep learning. I would say specifically deep learning. Machine learning was people were working earlier. So, and that's how the time of 2018, 17, when a lot of papers have started coming using deep learning. And that has also interested me. Okay, so it's the time to look into the deep learning. It's time to probably jump into the deep learning. That's how basically my work started more into the deep learning areas and so on. So during my PhD, I was mainly focusing on multimodal data around us. Because one thing I've realized, one modality is not enough. One modality is not enough. So in that case, you need to look at all the sensory information or all the information which are available with you. So in that case, you can think of human is the best examples of multimedia system because human can process information, human can say something, speak. So kind of audio, visual, speech, touch, and other sensors that you can have. So I've realized this is definitely going to be an amazing direction and a lot of work and applications you can build around that because most of my work revolves around some kind of applications because definitely, of course, I mean, there are a number of directions and the areas, research area, which are equally good and probably excelling in different direction, but it's all about interest. So my interest is all towards the application so that because whatever you can build, you can show to the people, you can use them directly and so on. So that's how I started during my PhD. I focused on a lot of on the building some kind of multimedia systems and building demos, building prototype and so on. And that's how once I joined IIIT Delhi, immediately after joining, I had a vision to start a multimedia lab, but with the help of a couple of colleagues and my initial, I would say, collaborator and the students, including you, Ramit, I have started MIDAS lab. So MIDAS stands for Multimodal Digital Media Analysis Lab, which leverages the multimodal data around us and use advances in machine learning, deep learning to solve a number of interesting problems around us. So that's how I would say I probably become a bit long introduction, but that's how my journey is through the research and how I come to IIIT Delhi.
No, I think that's really helpful for a lot of people watching this because turns out there's a big audience who is interested in machine learning and data science, but does not necessarily know where to start. And I think you are a great example of saying that we don't have to start with an undergraduate machine learning course. You know, having a mathematics background, being someone who has not started with computer engineering or computer science, going all the way to publishing deep learning papers today and having their own lab as CS faculty in one of the best research institutes in India. I think the length and description of the journey is probably something that people are going to ask for more. They would want to know more details, that how did you do X, how did you do Y? But I think, and in fact, a lot of the audience questions we have are around this. There are people who've asked, do we need to have a bachelor's degree in computer science to start? There are people who've asked, how do you go from India to universities abroad? What is the process? Would people want to go to Singapore? Would they want to go to Europe? There are all sorts of questions like these, and we can start taking some more of them. But I think a good number of the questions have already been answered through this introduction. So thank you for that.
Great.
So one of the first questions related to the machine learning field that has been asked is, how important is machine learning as compared to some of the other fields like software engineering, database management, you know, web development, full stack, etc., especially given that more recently there's been a boom in AI, machine learning, data science kind of jobs? So do you have any opinions on, should students focus on machine learning because it's a more booming field, or how does it compare with some of these other software engineering heavy fields?
So my response to this is, I mean, just like I've given the example of human, right? Human are the best example of multimedia system. And one example I have given also earlier, of course, we as a team, or as a, I would say together, you can do a lot of things. So in case of research area or the direction, like, so a computer systems or probably any thing that you use today. So even, I mean, this video call that we are having today.
Yeah.
It's not just one area that has contributed to that. It's all together. There is a team. There is a number of components to it. So including video processing, including speech processing, even the transmission to this. And even, I mean, writing to this, we need software engineering to write holes, such a massive program for that, right? So all, at least to me, all the research directions are equally important and very, very important. It's all about where your interest is. The people definitely should not run behind the hot areas around you, right? Because today, machine learning is the hot area, but tomorrow it could be something different.
Yeah.
So that's why it's better probably focus or probably choose the area where you can excel, where basically you have interest. So for example, there are people who have interest in computer architecture. They should do that because and basically without advancements in the computer architecture, because we might not be here. I mean we see a number of we all use GPUs and all those advances, right? All is coming through them, right? It's not like we are the one who are doing. So yeah. Every research area and the people have their own importance, and accordingly I think everyone have to contribute to that. So like in my case, I focus more on, I would say, the application. That's why basically I focus less on theory. I focus less on, I would say, the core machine learning or deep learning research. I focus more on just use. I'm more applied machine learning researcher. So I use the advances which are available in machine learning, computer science, or different areas like, sub areas like computer vision, natural language processing. I use them. I basically assemble them and to come up with solving some problem. So to me, all the research areas are equally important. It's, you should go behind what you like more. And basically people can also assess. And one thing, because I would like to share my experience, because once I've started applying for PhD program, I have more interest in theoretical computer science because I was from mathematical background. I thought, okay, so I could be, and now I have studied computer science, so I could probably contribute more on theoretical computer science. I was good at that as well. And I was, had a A grade and all, I mean, quite good grade as well. So, but as I said, after joining MTech, I started working on information retrieval specifically. I found it more interesting because, again, so not to criticize theoretical computer science, it's more about what I like more.
Yeah.
And that's how my association and probably area shifted towards information retrieval, data science, and finally that text processing has helped me to further grow towards not only text, but also, okay, so you're already doing natural language processing, how about go for speech processing? How about go for video processing? And that's how I expanded from one modality to the multiple modality and so on.
So I think the answer to the question in short is there are so many different fields and everything keeps making advances of their own. They're all interrelated. And this is something I agree with. In fact, you know, my career choices have also been many, where there are different cases where one needs to decide, you know, between finance and tower research or AI and share chat. And I think, not to say that AI is booming right now, so one would do it, but eventually I think you choose what interests you the most, because that's where you will exceed the most. So the one of the next questions is another interesting question, and I think I know some of the answer for this. But so given the fact that there's so many different opportunities around, things like, you know, internships, in fact, at our own lab at in Midas, internships at IIIT Delhi, internships with different companies, there's so many different opportunities for young data scientists to work with professors, labs, industries. How does one go about finding such opportunities? LinkedIn is obviously one such way, but what would you recommend? How do people keep in touch with what all opportunities are there? And how do they pick between so many different opportunities, between, let's say, a research lab versus interning at at an industrial position as a data scientist?
So I think it's a very interesting question. And before that, probably I just want to add, it also depends on the students and probably what career choice they want to make. Because at least what all the application I receive at IIIT Delhi at Midas, one thing I've noticed that majority of the application that I receive, who are interested in higher studies,
right?
And that makes sense, because probably we were doing some research which is visible to the community, which is visible to the people. And at least the initial students who have also probably got benefited by the kind of research they do.
Yeah.
Right. And that basically helped them. So, and definitely, I mean, there are many, many students who are doing internship at the top places, like industrial companies, I would say, for Google, Microsoft, and Amazon, and so on, just to name a few. Right. So it's all about, again, what your preference is, what your basically the aim is. If you are interested in software engineering, software development, go for the companies like which basically work in the area you want to work in. So, for example, if people are interested in finance, they should go for Tower Research, Goldman Sachs, and a number of companies are there. If the people interested in, for example, building some kind of web development based thing, so there are companies which are there which are excelling in that, right? So in a way, I mean, if you are interested in software development and related, again, so there are people who may be interested in I want to probably learn and I want to basically contribute how to make 4G, 5G and advances, LTE, yeah, and so on, right? So in that case, they need to look for and they want to build their career in so as a software developer or in probably consultant and architect and in those directions. So in that case, I mean, they should go for the companies. If the student interested in higher studies, my recommendation, and based on my experience, it has worked for them as well, go for probably some well-known research, not well-known, I would say, let me correct. So you should go for some research lab or at least some professor who can basically work with you closely and help you in formulating the problem statement, finalizing the problem statement, helping you probably in some possible direction, doing some brainstorming, and not only because completing the work is easy. Taking it to the logical conclusion is something takes time, because I have seen that most of the, at least not most, majority of the students I have seen, they want to have everything immediately. But in the research, it takes time, right? In software development, you start working, you probably come up with some visible output in a week or probably a month or so. But in research, it takes time. And so that is something you will learn, at least get the first taste of research while working with a research lab or some professor, India or abroad and so on. So the choice is depends on where you want to go for. If you are willing to go for higher studies, I think, so be it like masters, because the reason being, the people can say, okay, so I want to go higher studies, but not for PhD, but only for masters. And after that, I want to go for IT companies, right? So based on my experience, I mean, when you apply to any reputed universities, right, you see a massive number of application, I mean, the universities got, right? University get the huge number of application and you have to and they have to basically, they need to be very selective because they don't have any options for that, right? So what are the ways basically you can, and you will only be get selected if you probably somehow distinguish yourself from the rest of the profiles.
Yeah.
How you can do so? One possibility could be grade. Okay. One possibility could be, so where are you from? So for example, some people from IITs, some people from NITs, or some people even from some normal schools, right? Some people probably, they are quite proficient in English because earlier, the GRE, TOEFL, all these are also a good requirement for admission, right? Something you can change, something you cannot. So for example, I had a couple of students, they're not from IITs. Okay, so if they're not IITs, if they don't do something extra, they won't be distinguished themselves from the rest of the application. Similarly, there are people who are quite good at programming, quite good at probably other things, but not at English, because English may not be their first language, and probably they are probably from some place who haven't given them enough practice or the time for that. That's perfectly fine. Again, so how such people can basically excel, how such people can get admission to, say, for Stanford, MIT, UPenn, or Columbia University, and so on. So research, at least, is the way, because something they cannot change. But this something they can build and probably make a kind of add as an extra thing in their profile. And research is something they can do. And other people can say, okay, so I can also do the research in companies. I can mention that. The one thing I have noticed, at least based on my so limited, I would say, the experience so far, anyone can write anything, but there is no validity. So for example, I can write, I build a robot which work and interact well. I build a software which probably do X, Y, and Z, right? But there is no validity for that. Anybody can write in anything. But in the research, if you write something, a research paper will be published. And you can mention the link and that people can verify. And that, so it's more about the credibility. The people understand it, reputation, I would say. So that's how something, despite you lacking in some aspect, the research can give you that additional aspect to get admission to the top universities. And after that, again, so you can make your own choice, whether again go for higher studies, for PhD, or probably you can go for IT industry. Again, it's your choice.
Right. Yeah. No, so I think that's very helpful in understanding for some of the people where, as people who are just starting data science, there are multiple options. And I'd say two good ways of distinguishing them based on Professor Rajiv's answer would be more industry-oriented data science and more academic-oriented data science. Academic-oriented data science can be more focused if you're interested in pursuing a master's, a PhD. Perhaps it's also it's one of the ways in which people think about data science jobs abroad. I think 7 or 8 questions here are about how do we start data science jobs outside of India? And it might not be very easy to get some of these jobs directly from India, but one of the ways of becoming a data science in, let's say, Amazon US, Google US, things like this, Europe, Singapore, would be to do a master's degree, gain some more skills, more specific to a global machine learning and AI kind of spectrum. And based on those, apply for master's, PhD, get jobs abroad. The more industrial aspect of data science is where you focus on problems that are happening within India. A good example is what we do at ShareChat, for example, where it's not something that deals with solving research problems or writing research papers every day, but we're solving industry level problems to make tangible impact. A difference I've seen myself is in research, we write papers, we get this validation from conferences, our work is presented, gets covered by newspapers, everything. But it takes a while for it to reach an actual user. Whereas in industry, your work starts with the user where innovation might be limited. So I would suggest for most people, it's good to get a blend of both. If you're early in your career, in fact, that's something what I've done. Early in my career, I was focused in industry with software development, but I tried to balance my time and work with the Midas Lab in IIIT Delhi. And that's allowed me to get some academic exposure, publications as well. So although it might take some extra effort, the idea should be if you're in undergrad or even if not in undergrad, many research labs, including Midas, in fact, a lot in IIIT Delhi are welcoming applications from candidates of all age groups, all backgrounds, everything. The only idea is you should have an interest in data science and it's never too late to start. So my suggestion in alignment with Professor Rajiv's is let's try both, see what makes more sense. And if higher studies, academia seems more sense than, more research oriented. if your interests lie more towards industry, maybe more data scientist type of roles, the intersection of this often ends up becoming something like the research scientist kind of role at organizations like Google, where your work not just limited to only industrial problems or research, but kind of doing both.
So before you go next, I just want to add one more thing. So these days, very interestingly, a number of companies also have their research division and a lot of opportunity which are available to you. So for example, Google have their Google Research. Similarly, probably ShareChat might also have something, some wing or division which is primarily focusing on probably some research aspect. And similarly, TCS Research and number of Amazon Research and all those. So and basically, they have also started some residency program. So these residency programs are very, very useful for students and also well reputed, I would say. So that they can explore, which give them a blend of, I would say, the research as well as the industrial perspective of any work.
And to add to that, I think it's a very good point. Another, answering the first part of the question where how do you learn about such opportunities? I think one thing that I've learned through has been, again, LinkedIn, where, or even Twitter for that matter. If you think a certain position looks interesting, try reaching out to those people on LinkedIn. Interestingly, if you send messages on LinkedIn, initially I used to be scared of sending them, but over time I've learned that people are willing to help you. They're happy to talk about the kind of work they do. Reach out to people, try to understand what do they do as a data scientist. Do they solve more industrial problems? Does their data science job have a research flavor? Do they target publications? And you'll get a sense. Data science as a career also has multiple different variations, like software engineering has full stack, back end, routes where you could be more of an architect or you could become more of a software engineering manager. Similarly, data science has multiple of such aspects, and it's good to explore as many of these as possible younger in your career.
Yeah, so before you go to next question, I just probably I did not answer the last question fully. So because you ask about like what are the ways or are probably the source where the people should approach. So LinkedIn definitely is the one way. Another thing is not every people are active or equally active on LinkedIn, right? There are a number of popular researchers, at least probably I can give the perspective of academia. The number of researchers who are doing excellent work, but they're not active on LinkedIn, right? So the best way would be, I mean, you need to look at their lab website, their profile, and you also need to probably, because once you finalize, okay, which area you want to probably explore, you also need to do a kind of background work to find out what are the people you need to follow. So in that case, I mean, again, so different, and these people you can find in different ways. For example, in my case, I wanted to search, okay, so what are the people in information retrieval? If you do just do information retrieval something on Google Scholar, so Google Scholar will give a list of papers. And again, so it's just one source where you'll find a list of papers you can look at. Okay, so these are the people which are in my proximity or probably something even you can approach. And again, so you, at least in the era of globalization, proximity is not an issue. You can also approach to any people located anywhere. And that's what I always teach to, I always basically encourage. And that's how basically I got motivated from my professor at NUS. He said, I mean, contact anyone, I mean, and contact anyone and probably reach out to them, make a network and probably tell about what work you are doing, what interests you are and probably what they are doing and so on. So one thing I just want to add here, it's not like just approaching them. It's not just like approaching them through LinkedIn or email or probably finding these people. It's also about how you approach them, right? If you just do a message on LinkedIn, hey professor, I'm looking for a internship. I have great interest in data science. Please give me opportunity. I cannot help because I receive hundreds of such messages every week. I cannot respond to all those. And again, so even though I have a time, I mean, again, it's all about selectiveness. It's all about who give a different, I would say, the flavor to their profile, how you are different. Because when I was preparing for interviews, one of my seniors says, okay, so when you enter the inter room, I mean the interview room, I mean, if it is very as usual as the other candidate, I mean, they are not going to have you. So probably what different you can do. So once you enter the interview room, you can ask them rather than they ask, you ask, hi, how are you doing? Rather than they ask you. And so it's give you all the confidence. So again, so just giving different flavor to that. So at least in academia case, if you are approaching anywhere, it's better to, since it's about research work, it's better to basically look at the some of the work of that professor. And if you can do a kind of read that paper and probably do a critic analysis and say, okay, so hey, professor, I mean, I read this paper, I really found interesting or bad, whatever you feel, and say, okay, so this is something, I mean, we need to improve on, or this is something, I mean, if I have to work on this, I mean, where I can contribute on. So if you highlight that, then definitely, I mean, your profile grab my attention and anyone's attention.
Yeah.
And so that's how I think you need to approach. So of course, I mean, you can find the people through different sources, different looking at their website or probably LinkedIn or even job portal and so on. But in order to distinguish yourself again, you need to probably find better ways to approach them. So read their work, comment on what they are doing or how you can contribute specifically, what's your strength is, how you can relate your skills with the kind of requirement the professor or probably other lab have.
Yeah.
And the same application for industrial companies as well.
Yeah.
So for example, Google research might have some vision or some direction they want to work in.
Yeah.
So if you are applying them, you need to somehow relate them either in interview, either in while applying. And all these are matters. All these things are matters.
I think in short, and this is something I learned also after I think a year or two of approaching people, there's so many people like us, right? The industry is so competitive. In one word, you need to show how you add value. And that value, you can only show if you've done homework around what this person does and tell them that, you know, this is how we can improve. And it's actually good that you've brought this point up, because the next questions are actually about this, that what should students be doing when they try to approach different labs? For example, if they want to come from IDAS or they want to go for an industrial job, I think we've already answered part of it, which is around developing value. The second part of the question is more around what are some of the absolutely basic prerequisites that people need before entering into data science. Like one prerequisite, for example, is of course we need to have some mathematics background. Now, some mathematics background can mean a little introduction to statistics, probability. So the basic question from a lot of people, in fact, is what are some of the key basic prerequisites in getting started with deep learning, machine learning? What are some of the main subjects that people should read either online, take courses on, etc.?
Okay, so prerequisite in a sense, I mean, definitely the mathematics is the kind of core of at least data science, right? So, I mean, definitely you need to have the fundamental probability, statistics, linear algebra and all those. And again, fortunately, in the era of globalization, you'll find a lot of amazing resources available, publicly available on the website. And thanks to a number of universities, including, I mean, a number of initiatives from Indian government as well, like NPTEL is there, right? Where the professor from IITs and many others, I mean, they take classes on number of topics. So this could be one of the best source. Similarly, I mean, they can also look at, I mean, some institute like Stanford, I mean, all those, I mean, they make their all the lectures available to publicly available. So that is something, I mean, people can get benefit and probably create their fundamental at least clear. And again, so those who afford, I mean, if you think, I mean, they can take additional courses which can give them more hands-on experience and all those things are again there. It is all up to your choice. It's not mandatory, I would say.
Yeah.
Because all the fundamentals you can get at least through, I mean, a lot of free resources which are available around us and we can get benefited from them.
Add to that quickly, one of the things that, you know, as part of, I'd say the last 1-2 months that I've been working with Scalar Academy, for example, I think some of the course that they are building has also been similar to what Professor Rajiv is mentioning. So the basic foundation, I think people often think they need a computer science foundation, but you have to start with a maths foundation. And I think that's also what's been Professor Rajiv's secret, because he started his studies with maths, not computers like us. So there's definitely a maths background that comes into play. In fact, I go as far as saying that a lot of data science is more about looking at the data rather than building complex models. And both the foundation of basic data processing and complex models, all of it starts with basic maths like stats, probability. Over time, it moves to things like calculus, multivariate calculus, things like this. So I think two sets of prerequisites. One is more on the theoretical side, which is maths heavy. Second is more on the practical side. I think, and this is something we do in our evaluation at Midas as well, where we basically would ask students to do an assignment in Python. And we suggest Python because it's such a rich ecosystem. So many libraries are there. So many things are easy to do. So it's important for students not to just look at courses or do book readings where there's no hands-on experimentation. You only learn after you do. So a suggestion would also be to look for courses that involve hands-on assignments where you can actually try building out your own neural network. In fact, in today's day and age, it's a funny thing, like linked lists or like trees, we ask them in interviews, but we don't use them in our job. But we need them, we need to understand how they work, because eventually you can't just import things in code which you don't know how they work internally. Similar with data science, a lot of people know, or in fact today it's as simple as 2 or 3 lines to create your own big, you know, transformer, convolution neural network. But how many of these people actually understand how gradient descent and the training of that neural network works? Very few. So focus on the kind of courses where you can try out these basics and do these things from the ground up.
So I think that's a very, very valid point. So in fact, at Midas, I mean, this is one of the key criteria that we have. We don't just interview. As the first step, we always give some tasks.
Yeah.
And because we receive humongous, I mean, a huge number of applications.
I think last year was more than 1,000. So I can...
Yeah. So, and the first criteria that we give, I mean, you need to give the we give some task and ask them. And basically, a lot of application filter out, because that also give the, help us to check the motivation of the student as well. And usually, all the application that we received, the students who complete the task, we try to give a lot of attention to all those submissions, go them thoroughly and look for probably what are the students who can go for the next round of interview or so. But one thing I really want to highlight, it may probably sound not so good, but it's very selective, I would say the very competitive process.
Yeah.
Because recently, while discussing with one of my colleagues, he said, so competition is just like a way like this. If you want to get admission to a PhD program, you need to complete half of the PhD work to get the admission.
Yeah.
So because it's very competitive, the same thing applies here as well. If you want to get enrolled to some well-reputed industry or probably the lab or anyone, you need to also add value to that. And because it's very competitive, so don't just probably go through the book. You also need to do some hands-on, do the practice so that you can help in the definitely, our expectation is not like, I mean, we want you to probably be expert in machine learning, but at least we expect you to have some understanding. And during the interview, we ask very this basic simple questions, right? I mean, so what is gradient descent? What is linear algebra? What is all those? And all those, I mean, very simple questions related to that to check your foundation.
Yeah, agreed. I think for anyone who is looking to start in data science, whether you're someone who's just starting out fresh with undergraduate, or it's someone who has multiple years of experience in industry, there are multiple parts. One, people that look at are the mathematical basics. How well do you understand things like linear algebra, calculus? How well do you understand basic machine learning algorithms? This doesn't mean, you know, you are solving problem like sentiment classification on Twitter. It means simple things like, do you understand how a basic neural network is trained? And the third and most important thing, which often helps people who are already in software engineering or even students who've studied data structures algorithms, is the coding aspect of it. As much of machine learning as you learn theoretically, even in research, and people often forget this, even when we write research papers, a lot of the time goes in coding. So it's important to not just have theoretical skills, but also to be able to implement these with practical coding. And there's altogether a new world now which focuses on ML operations. This is something we do in Midas in one of the industrial collaborations that we have. This is what happens in industry. So you've made a machine learning model. How do you scale this machine learning model to serve so many requests that come in a minute? How does that work? For example, more recently, Google Search now uses BERT. It's a transformer-based NLP model for searching. How do we take BERT from just a research experiment to something that can serve millions of queries in seconds? This whole field around machine learning engineering, machine learning ops, building and deploying models, Docker, Kubernetes, this is another important field that students should focus on.
So before you go next, I believe we missed one part because we're talking about internship. I have mainly covered the internship in India.
Yeah.
So regarding internship in, I mean, other places, So there are several ways which work. So there are a number of programs which are established between different countries and probably supported by different organizations, which support you to probably visit different institutions in the world and do your internship. So to name a few, like MITAC is one of the popular one. Similarly, S.N. Bose Fellowship is also a very popular one. So these are similarly, NTU has, I forgot the name, but NTU Singapore also have some fellowship for inviting internship application. And in the world, so basically there are numerous such fellowship programs for internship which are already there. So
Right.
you need to also explore that. So this is one way of getting to, I would say, the international internship. So since it's an international internship, often in some cases many people are not already aware of this, so somehow they miss it. So at least this is one thing they should try.
Right.
Second thing, which also comes through your network. When I say network, so like through your professor, because your professor might have some network with the, they have some collaborative work with us at different universities, industry, in different parts of the world. And that's how basically you can basically get it. Third way, basically you can get the international internship. Many of my students travels a lot because they also attend the different conferences held worldwide. So like in 2020, at least 15 students from our lab have attended AAAI conference in New York. And that's how basically they get to meet a number of people around from across the globe who are experts
Yeah.
in doing amazing work. And that's how the, because networking always help, because you, through the network, when you get to know the people, at least you pass the first hurdle of getting to know them. Or probably, because once you meet, I mean, definitely you can tell about what kind of work you are doing, what value you can add on to the research the other people are doing. And you can also get to know, I mean, what are the people who are interested in your profile. And so definitely these networking through conferences help a lot. And fortunately, many of students who attended conference last year, now they got to the amazing places for their either for higher studies, for further job, for internship, and all those.
I think that's an important point, and in fact, that was actually the next question where people were asking, how do you go about foreign internships? So everyone has their answer. And to add to this, I'll give a short example. And this actually shows why academic research or research papers don't need to be only for MS applications. So I had a friend who was amongst these 15 people who came with us to New York for the conference, and his interest was purely in data science job, not necessarily interested in PhD or academics, but he had a research paper. And what that research paper does on your resume when you apply to any industrial company is it sets you apart from hundreds of other applicants. Not everyone will have a top-rated research paper. So it shows that you are capable of A, working in a team, B, getting your work reviewed by, top-level reviewers, getting it published. You can do the code for it, you can do the paper writing, documentation, you can present your work globally. And a lot of such conferences, in fact, which are now happening virtually, so it's the chance to take an advantage of these things. They have sponsor booths. All companies, Google, Microsoft, Facebook, all of these companies have booths over there, and they're very excited to have people who have a publication background. I'd say, in fact, if you look at most data science and AI related jobs, even machine learning engineers, often they say that in preferred qualifications, you'll always find a bullet point that says publications are not required, but are a very strong plus point. And to speak to that point, the friend who was there in New York, he within I think 2 days he got an internship with one of the AI companies in New York. So, and he was in at that point he was in India. So the whole idea is publications can really set you, and research, even if you don't write publications, even just reading publications and staying up to date with latest research or implementing research papers is a good way of getting into the industry and keeping up with latest cutting edge data science related things. I think we have time for one last super quick question. We'll be skipping some of the questions, but feel free to add comments to this YouTube video or on LinkedIn. We'll try to get back to these or perhaps, do another at some point. Okay, so yeah, I think this is a good question. This says, how would you say that preparation or the career path for someone in data science is different when they have multiple years of experience? So basically, a few people are worried that it's been a few years that they have done software engineering. In fact, like you had done some software engineering. I've done 3 years of software engineering. So some people are worried that, you know, they've already crossed 10 plus years of experience or 5 plus years of experience. How do we shift from software engineering to data science now? What kind of skills do we need to build up? What is the easiest way of maybe trying to get into data science while being in a software industry related job?
I think it's a very, very interesting and very good question. And I think experience matters, right? I mean, so even though you don't have experience in data science, right? So whatever the experience you have acquired, be it software development, software engineering, is going to help you because you have different approach or probably you have learned a lot, which will help you in quickly, which will help you basically quickly learn something new. Because at least in academia, if you see, I mean, the trend changes very quickly, like before the deep learning. For example, deep learning, at least in the conferences, getting a lot of, the most of the people started using deep learning for different problems around probably around 2014, 2015. You'll see a lot of papers coming in the deep learning. So the people who are not working in area of artificial intelligence and deep learning switch to that. And at that time, probably their experience in the academia would be 30 years, 20 years, 35 years, and so on.
Yeah.
So it's never too late. I mean, even though you have, and that's how people switch, right? Because you can switch to a new area. You can switch to something over the years, over the month. It's not like quick learning, bit like in different ways, and so on. So at least to me, I mean, it is going to be helpful because whatever the new skill that you have to learn, I mean, it's basically few week or probably few months task.
Yeah.
But so just think in that way. Of course, you have learned all the fundamental for data science and you already have additional, I would say, the benefit of having 10 years of experience in software engineering.
Yeah.
So, I mean, you can complete all those fundamental in a few months or probably in a year, 2 year. But after that, I mean, you have 2 plus 10 years of experience in data science, kind of, because you can apply 10 years of your software engineering to the 2 years of data science that you learned, and you can probably excel. And there is numerous such examples. People are doing amazing works, both in industry as well as in academia.
Yeah. No, I think that's
so it's never too late. It's never too late.
Yeah.
It's never too late.
I'd say it's an advantage, like Professor Rajiv said, that if you have already some software engineering, industrial coding related experience, this is something that helps. Because like we mentioned, data science is not just about the maths and neural network theory, but also about how you can implement this. ML engineering, ML ops might be a good career path to transition into a research scientist if that's what, you know, interests you the most. So in short, look for courses that might have multiple variations, like maybe a beginner kind of course, which allows you to start with coding, Python, etc. And maybe there are some courses which are more intermediate or advanced where it assumes that the person knows already how to code and you just learn more on the theory so that you know how to apply this with the skills that you already have. Awesome. So although we do have, I think, more than 20 more questions to go over, but we're almost crossing an hour now. So we'll stop bothering Professor Rajiv with so many more questions. And I'd like to thank you for taking the time out. I know it's a weekday and everything, and I know how busy you are. So from that perspective, we're really grateful to have you. And for the audience, if you have questions, more questions, follow-ups on any of these things, we're always reachable through the comments on LinkedIn, YouTube, through the email IDs that we have of the lab. And we're always there to help people who want to start a career in data science. And I think a tagline that I've picked up from what Professor Rajiv has said, that it's never too late. So keep that in mind, and you know, best wishes to people starting their data science career and journey.
Thank you so much, Ramit. And it's my pleasure, and it's great interacting with you. And I hope our interaction can help some of the brilliant mind and bright minds. And so with that hope, yeah, let's wish them best of luck. And just for, I mean, some of the students, reference, in case they want to apply for the Midas Lab, we always basically post the different opportunity on our social media pages. And again, so you can also look to those pages, follow them, and get the latest updates from there. Thank you so much.
Awesome. Thank you, everyone. Bye-bye.